and welcome to this edition of Sojourners Along the Way. Today is going to be a very interesting program. You're going to get the opportunity to experience some television magic. I deliberately wore this t-shirt because of what's on it. It does relate to some aspects of this program. It says WWJD. That was a very common, popular expression, I don't know how long ago. And I didn't buy the t-shirt, it was given to me, but I like it. The WWJD, what does that stand for? Well, it stands for, what would Jesus do? And I was never really satisfied with that, because asking the question, what would Jesus do? Some people could say, well, that was Jesus, and he did it, and that's fine. So I like to add a line to it that says, what would Jesus do? I will do it. Or if you want, you could say, I'll do the same. Okay? We need to do what's the right thing to do. This edition of Sojourners Along the Way is going to take a closer look at something very American. What do we have in the United States of America that is truly American? I'm going to give you some time to think about that, because I want to tell you about something that I am in the process of trying to get together. I'm going to do my very first ever mini-series. It should be a challenge, and hopefully it will be very informative. Hopefully the mini-series will consist of three programs. I don't think I have yet said on the air that for the fourth time in my life, I am an Ohio University student. I have two undergraduate degrees. I have half of a master's from Ohio University in education, and I have a master's degree in international affairs from Ohio University. And now I am presently a student again, so I can learn more about what I am doing here at ACTV and hopefully to apply it, which is what I'm hoping to do with the mini-series. I'm going to use a portion of my short script. We'll see how that comes together. I hope it will work. The mini-series is going to focus on a very serious topic, and that topic is grief. I'm very fortunate that Tammy Glogley was willing to share her story. That will be program number two. I want to invite the viewing audience that you can participate in this. If you'd like to share your story, your experience with grief, your ideas of how to help people with grief, contact us. That would be sojourners3.tv@gmail. My plan. First program, have the short script, and then a counselor to come on that will talk about grief, a professional counselor. Program number two will be Tammy. Program number three, I'm hoping that a few professional counselors will agree to do a round robin, so that way we can answer questions and discuss what the viewing audience sends in. So please contact via email, or if you don't do email, you can send it through the mail, ACTV, Richland Avenue, and I believe it's Suite 100, Athens, Ohio, A-T-H-E-N-S, Ohio, 45701. The question I asked was, what do we have in the U.S. of A. that is truly American? Note, I'm all for free enterprise, but where have we gone with this? Have we gone to a place of no return? In our pursuit for the dollar, have we sold the United States of America and ourselves? This is not the topic for today, but it certainly relates to our topic, freedom. Celebrating the 4th of July. Isn't TV magic wonderful? Before there was an empty desk, and now look what has transpired. We have all of these books. I actually went to the Athens County Public Library and borrowed all of these books, and I will be returning them. I hope you will take advantage of the resources that are available. Let's make this celebration one that has a foundation. We need to learn our history. People, when asked about what did you do, what do you think of when you hear the words 4th of July, the answers were picnics and barbecues and fireworks and food and family and fun, which is, there's nothing wrong with that. That should be a part of the celebration of the 4th of July. But many of us don't know the truth, the foundation. We don't know the beginning of the 4th of July. A number of these books have a lot of good information in them, and I hope you will take advantage of them, okay? I'm not going to read from the books because we'd need many more shows than just what we have available, but I do want to introduce the books to you. This is this overall overview of the United States. So, we need to learn our history. How were we founded? What happened? Why? This one in 1776. A lot of people know the year 1776, but what's important about that year? What happened? Who was involved? What did they do? Why? This one is a fun book, okay? It's called The American Revolution for Kids, A History with 21 Activities. If you would like to reinforce our history and help the kids, there's some fun activities in this book. And again, these books are all available at the Athens County Library. This book is Give Me Liberty. A lot of people know Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death. But who said it and why? Where was it originally written? So, Give Me Liberty, the story of the Declaration of Independence. How does the Declaration of Independence fit into the 4th of July? Is there a connection? A new nation, the United States, and it gives a time period, 1783 to 1815. This one is really cute. I hope you remember a program that Barb Martin did. Barb Martin is a speech pathologist, and on one of the program that she did, she said, you don't have to read every single word that's in the book, especially when you're dealing with children. Because a lot of these books, if you looked at them, you really need to have a very good vocabulary in order to understand what is written. You see this? This is supposed to be a children's book, and it is. But look at the amount of words. You have to judge what books are appropriate for children. Independence Day. Again, I really want to put in a plug. Please take advantage of the library. There's a lot of good stuff. The Boston Tea Party. Why was it called the Boston Tea Party? What took place? How big a tea party was it? What kind of tea did they serve? Okay, what happened? What's the truth about the Boston Tea Party? And who was involved? You know, we talk about the original 13 colonies. Do you know what the original 13 colonies were? I'm going to give you a list, okay? See if you agree with this or not. Massachusetts, New Hampshire, New York, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia. How many was that? Are they the original 13 colonies? Do you know that? Did I give you the truth or not? Check it out. Don't always believe everything you hear on television. The Declaration of Independence. Who was the one that wrote it? How did it happen? Why? What was behind the writing of the Declaration of Independence? And this book has a website, so for the Declaration of Independence, you can go to www.law.indiana.edu, and then from there you can find the Declaration of Independence. declaring independence, drafting the documents, you can go to, this says lcweb.loc.gov/exhibits/DECLARA/DECLARA.1.htm. Okay, and there are a couple of other websites. Check it out. You can actually Google the Declaration of Independence and you'll get some really interesting information. Independence Day. We're getting ready to celebrate our Independence Day. And I'm going to make this statement again. Freedom is not free. It comes at great cost. And this one is called the Birthday of the United States. I believe it is this one that is, yeah, this is the one. See? You see how few words are on these pages? But even with that, some of the vocabulary, because you have to remember, the books typically will have a higher vocabulary. We have to think on terms of the child's concepts. What do they understand? So you don't have to read every word that's in the book. Even if it just has a few words, do they know all those words? And if they don't, help them to learn. Please. If your parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, anybody in a child's life, please get them accustomed. Help them to read books. Help them to look at books. You can look at the pictures and make up stories. That is one of the things that Barb Martin was advocating. You don't have to read every word. And then the signers and my flag. Now, the signers. How many signers were on the Declaration of Independence? You know, we talked about there being 13 original colonies, but how many signers? Was there just one, two, three? How many signers per colony, and were they all representing their colony? So, I believe that is the Latin. Nope, there's one more. The flag we love. Now, in the United States, we also do have a holiday that is called Flag Day, and we should be very proud. I have mentioned on previous programs that I have had the opportunity to live outside of the United States. And I would challenge anybody. Yes, the United States has problems. Nobody is perfect. Therefore, no country could be perfect. But if you're really going to rag on the United States, I will challenge you. I have lived a total of 7 years of my life outside of the United States. I would say maybe after 1 year, if that doesn't convince you, then go for more. Go for all 7 years. And see what you think about the United States. And we would have to talk about what countries to go to, but we'll do that off camera. Let's take a closer look at some of these books. It does have a section on the Declaration of Independence, so I'm going to just read a few of the things from that. The Declaration of Independence, July 2nd, 1776, was approved in the wording by the Continental Congress. On July 4, 1776, the delegates voted to accept it and declare America's independence from Great Britain. On July 8, 1776, the declaration was read in public for the first time. Outside Independence Hall, Philadelphia, accompanied by the ringing of the Liberty Bell. On July 19th, Congress ordered it engrossed in script on parchment, and on August the 2nd, 1776, the members of Congress signed the parchment copy. Then, on another entry, on July the 3rd, 1776, the day following the approval by Congress of the Declaration of Independence, John Adams wrote to his wife, Abigail, I am apt to believe that it will be celebrated by succeeding generations as the great anniversary festival. It ought to be commemorated as the day of deliverance by solemn acts of devotion to God Almighty. Our founding fathers acknowledged God from the very get-go. As the parchment copy of the Declaration of Independence was being signed by the members of the Continental Congress, August 2, 1776, Samuel Adams declared, "We have this day restored the sovereign to whom all men ought to be obedient. He reigns in heaven, and from the rising to the setting of the sun, let his kingdom come." I've said that you can take this book and you can open it to any page and you will find lots of information. So I'm going to do that. I do have some papers in it because I like this book a lot. And I do periodically just pick it up. This happens to have paper there, so I'm not going to go there. I'm going to go someplace that I don't have a paper. There we go. See, no papers marking this one. This is from Woodrow Wilson, whose lifespan was from 1856 to 1924. He became the 28th president of the United States. Now that would be another fun thing to do. How many presidents can you name? How about the children in your life? Are they learning our presidents? And is it important? It was a long time ago. What relevancy does it have for today? Well, if we don't know our history, we're doomed. If we don't know what our documents say, and I do have a copy of the Constitution of the United States. It's nice, small, see? Not that big. And people will talk about things, but they don't know what it actually says. I'm not going to take the time to read it because it would take quite a bit of time, more than what we have for today. But people are constantly talking about, it's my right as a United States citizen. What about your responsibilities as a United States citizen? Have you learned some of our history? Are you willing to protect those rights? Or is that supposed to be somebody else's job? Let the other person do it. I have the right to enjoy the freedoms with no responsibility. We have to get rid of that kind of mindset. And unfortunately, it is the way a lot of people think. Somebody else is supposed to do that. Again, I mentioned, I do say thank you to the people that are in our military. I hope they don't have to give their lives, but they know that when they sign up to join the military, they know that may be a very real possibility. We need to be thankful and not to criticize them. They're doing their job. Woodrow Wilson became the 28th president of the United States after having served as the governor of New Jersey. Now that makes me happy. I told you I randomly opened this book and it happened to go to Woodrow Wilson. My home state is New Jersey. He was an educator, author, and the president of Princeton University. Now, if you don't know, Princeton also has a theological seminary, School of Divinity, attached to it. And it used to be one of the top in the nations, in our nation, and in the nations, I could say it that way too. I think they've gotten a little bit more liberal over the years. Again, we need to get back to the roots, and I will say the greatest roots of all that we need to get back to are the Bible. In fact, there's a section in this book and other places that I've read that they say, without knowing the Bible, your education is not complete. That's a paraphrase, please. And did you know that originally education, our classrooms, our teachers. Do you know what they use to teach reading? Do you have any idea? They taught reading with the Bible. Children learned the alphabet using scriptures. And now we're being told, oh, no, 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 separation of church and state. Do you know where that was first written? Do you know who was the one that said it? Thomas Jefferson was the one who first said it. And it was in a private letter. What do you think, I'm sorry, Woodrow Wilson, I'll get back to you. What do you think he meant when he said separation of church and state? It certainly could not mean how it's being told today. There's an expression, if you tell a lie loud enough and long enough, people will believe it. Well, people have now believed that statement to mean separation of church and state, and the two shall not come together. You look in this document, in this book, it will show you the original documents of some of our state constitutions. And you know what they said? In order to be, I know you don't, so I'm going to tell you. In order to be a politician in that state, you had to be a Christian. And in some states, they even made it more specific and said that you had to acknowledge Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Separation of church and state? It's been so misused, so misunderstood. All right, back to Woodrow Wilson. God's own presence, where justice and mercy are reconciled, and the judge and the brother are one. God helping me, I will not fail. That was what he said in his inaugural address on March the 4th, 1913. God's own presence, where justice and mercy are reconciled, and the judge and the brother are one. God helping me, I will not fail. Woodrow Wilson did a lot for this country. Let's do one more. How about Congress of the United States of America, October the 3rd, 1863, passed an act of Congress designating an annual National Day of Thanksgiving as proclaimed by President Abraham Lincoln. I do therefore invite my fellow citizens in every part of the United States to set apart and observe the last Thursday of November next as a day of thanksgiving and praise to our beneficent Father who dwelleth in the heavens. It is announced in the Holy Scriptures and proven by all history that those nations are blessed whose God is the Lord. It has seemed to me fit and proper that God should be solemnly, reverently, and gratefully acknowledged as with one heart and one voice by the whole American people. I think that's a good place to stop this section. There are a lot of books. Go to the Athens County Library and see about borrowing these books to share for the 4th of July. And I did put in a request that Athens County Library will get this book, so it will be available to you. But you might have fun owning your own copy of it. Do you know what our national debt is and to whom? To help you get a perspective on that, I have to ask you the question. What does $1 trillion look like? All this talk about stimulus packages and bailouts, $1 billion, $100 billion, $800 billion, $1 trillion. What does that look like? These various numbers are tossed around like so many doggy treats. Google SketchUp will give us a sense of exactly what $1 million looks like. We'll start with $100 bill. Currently, that is our largest U.S. denomination in general circulation. Most people have seen them. Some have owned them. A packet of 100 $100 bills is less than a half inch thick and contains $10,000. It fits in your pocket easily and is more than enough for a few weeks of total fun. This next little pile is $1 million. That's 100 packets of $10,000. You could stuff that into a grocery bag and walk around with it. While a measly $1 million looks a little unimpressive, how about $100 million? It is a little bit more respectable. It fits neatly on a standard pallet. And $1 billion. Now we're getting somewhere. Next, we'll look at $1 trillion. This is the number we've been hearing so much about. $1 trillion! What is $1 trillion? Well, it's 1,000,000,000. It's 1,000,000,000,000. It's 1 followed by 12 zeros. Of course, a zero, big deal. It's just a zero, you know. But it has 1 in the front. 1 followed by 12 zeros. Are you ready? It's very surprising. This is what $1 trillion looks like. Notice those pallets are double stacked next to the man. Now, when I first saw this and I looked at it, I went, where's the man? What are you talking about, double stacked next to the man? Can you see the man? The stacks are the same height as the man, and they're double pallets. How much did one pallet hold? Those are $100 bills. Remember that. They're stacks and stacks and stacks of $100 bills. So the next time you hear someone toss around the phrase, $1 trillion, oh, we can do that. No problem. $1 trillion. We can bail them out. We can help them. We can write it off. What is the debt of the United States of America? Do you have any idea? Our debt in the USA is over $19 trillion, and it's going up. There are a number of websites. You can Google it, national debt, and there are a number of websites. They may vary from $18 trillion plus over $19 trillion. In fact, the amount that I found on one site, U.S. dollars, $19,230,634,229,000. How do we get in debt like that? How does that happen? How would your family work? How would your home, running your home, paying your bills? Could you do that with a deficit? We're not even going to say in the trillions of dollars because that would be unrealistic. But what kind of debt are you living with? And how can you get it down? I, for one, am very, very pleased to be able to say that I am debt-free. I worked at it. I had to work hard at it because I have a lot of college, and college is expensive. But when I walked the line, I was debt-free at that time. I made my sacrifices along the way. Maybe that's something we should teach our country, our government. If you don't have the money, don't spend it. Total federal government debt in 2015, at the end of fiscal year 2015, the gross U.S., and it was pretty gross too, U.S. federal government debt was estimated at $18.628 trillion, according to the fiscal year 16 federal budget. That doesn't sound like a budget to me. That sounds like an IOU. So who does the United States owe this money to? You might be surprised. The largest portion of our money, as you can see from that pie chart, is to international investors. 34%. The United States is for sale. You want a piece of it? Just takes money. Domestic private investors, another 15%. So, private investors, international and national, has about 50% of our debt. Others, we have federal accounts. Then I love this. They're telling us that there's other, and it's $895 billion. But that's only 5%. That's no problem. But it's billions of dollars. State and local governments, another $858 billion. And then the Federal Reserve, again, this is not the theme for this program, but it is a backdrop for us. United States of America, land of the free, home of the brave. Maybe we need a new definition. Are we free with a debt like that? We can't call that free. Now, back to the original question. This is what our program is focusing on for today. What do we have in the U.S. of A. that is truly American? An answer is our founding documents and holidays celebrating the cause. And that's why I'm wearing this. I like to try to coordinate some of my clothes to what my program's going to be about. And so today, I want to be very patriotic. Again, I have lived outside of the United States, and I love my country. I do. I love my country very much, and I want to see us succeed. I want us to see us get back to where we were at one time. We're not there now. We're not. Don't fool yourself. We aren't there because we've allowed things to slip through our fingers. I'm not going to focus on that today. But I want you to think about our history. Where did we come from? I'm going to say this phrase a few times. Freedom is not free. We're called the land of the free, the home of the brave. But it cost, and it cost a lot. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. A few of the last Sojourners Along the Way programs were celebrations. And this one is too. And we should celebrate. We should. We should have the greatest party of all. But I want to challenge you, encourage you, exhort you. Let's make our celebrations also have some substance to them. Not just the barbecues, but let's talk about what happened in the beginning, okay? I want to read you some quotes. And I have used this book before. It's called America's God and Country. It's an encyclopedia of quotations by William J. Federer. I don't know if I ever said this on the program before, but I used to do a radio program for out of Zanesville, and I was able to do an interview with him about this book. This book is an encyclopedia. It is an encyclopedia of primary sources, which means that these are the originals, okay? It's not like going to a history book and they're quoting something else. This is quoting the actual document or the actual person. So I'm going to read these seven questions to you. One, I believe that the next half century will determine if we will advance the cause of Christian civilization or revert to the horrors of brutal paganism. Two, education is useless without the Bible. Three, let every student be plainly instructed and earnestly pressed to consider well the main end of his life and studies is to know God and Jesus Christ, which is eternal life. Number four, to suppose that the eye, with all its inimitable contrivances could have been formed by natural selections seems, I freely confess, absurd in the highest degree. Number 5, nonviolence is the answer to the crucial political and moral questions of our time. The need for man to overcome oppression and violence without resorting to oppression and violence. Number 6, whoever shall introduce into public affairs the principles of primitive Christianity will change the face of the world. Number 7, if we ever forget that we are one nation under God, then we will be one nation gone under. Who made these statements, asked these questions? They're leaders from our country. The answers are, number 1, President Theodore Roosevelt. Number 2, Noah Webster. Number 3, Harvard University. That was in 1642. Number 4, Charles Darwin. Number 5, Martin Luther King Jr. Number 6, Benjamin Franklin. Number 7, President Ronald Reagan. This book has a lot of good information. I hope you will take advantage, get a copy of it, and read it. It's not the type of book that you would read from cover to cover, but it's a fun book you can open. I love books like that. It's a book you can open any place and start reading. And I just happened to open up to George Washington, which I think is rather appropriate for today's program, since George Washington had a lot to do with the founding of this country and was our very first president of the United States. We do have a great deal to be thankful for, and we should celebrate, and we should be very thankful for all the lives that were given so that way we could have this country. So this edition of Sojourners Along the Way is addressing the 4th of July. Did you ever notice this is one of the few holidays that the date does not change? We celebrate the 4th of July on the 4th of July. It's not like some of our holidays, like even Thanksgiving, which is one of our few national holidays. It changes according to the calendar because it's always the 4th Thursday of November. But we always celebrate the 4th of July on the 4th of July. Why do we have the 4th of July? What happened? When? How is the 4th celebrated? This is going to be a very brief history lesson. Do you recall our history? What were we originally? More than that, why did people come to this country? Why did they leave their families, friends, homes, fortune, stable life to come to a new world? This is a topic for another day, but something to think about today. And as you celebrate the 4th of July. Again, we have great cause to give thanks for this nation. Let's not take it for granted. Many of us have heard of the Declaration of Independence. How many of us know what it says? What does it stand for? Who are the authors of it? To whom was it written and why? I am not going to read the entire document, but you might consider doing that with your family and or friends for part of your celebration of the 4th of July. And again, for young children, do work at the wording and making it something that they can understand. Let's go back to our roots and gain some understanding. So this is a portion of the Declaration of Independence. In Congress, July 4th, 1776, the unanimous declaration of the United States of America when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them. A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes, and accordingly all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursuing invariably the same object evinces a design to reduce them under absolute deposition, oh dear, forgive me, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferances of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of the present King of Great Britain is a history of repeated injuries and insurrections. I'm sorry, that word just doesn't want to come out right. All having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world. And then there is a long, long and list and detailed, itemized grievances were given. The Declaration of Independence closed with the following paragraph. We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do in the name and by authority of the good people of these colonies solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies are, and of right, ought to be free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free and independent states, they have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract and alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And the closing line for the Declaration of Independence is, and for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. Did you notice how many times God was mentioned? Not necessarily by the word God. So why do we now, and this is another aside, But it's a very important one because this was the founding of our country. And they were basing it on a relationship with God. So why are we trying to kick God out of this country? That's a program for another day. Let's return to the closing lines of the Declaration of Independence. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. A number of these patriots willingly did just that. They gave of themselves and themselves their lives. Patrick Henry closed his speech in the Second Virginia Convention in March 1775 with his famous words, which included, "Gentlemen may cry, peace, peace, but there is no peace." And aside, that's a quote from the Bible that he just gave. "Gentlemen may cry, peace, peace, but there is no peace. The war is actually begun. The next gale that sweeps from the north will bring to our ears the clash of resounding arms. Our brethren are already in the field. Why stand we here idle? What is it that gentlemen wish? What would they have? Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death." Those are the words that many people are very familiar with. Give me liberty or give me death. How many of the founding parents of this country did just that? They gave their lives so we could have the celebration that we will on July the 4th. And again, did you notice his references to the Bible and to God? How about Nathan Hale? Nathan Hale has a very interesting story, and you can find that in one of the books that I borrowed from the Athens County Library. Right before he was executed, was asked if he had any final statements to make. You know what he said? This is a famous comment that many people do know. His comment was, "I only regret that I have but one life to lose for my country." If you were to ask people today, citizens of the United States, are they willing to die for the United States? How many people do you think would say, "Yes, I'm willing to die for the United States"? I want to put in a plug for our military. I don't want to see war. I really don't. But I am very thankful for our military and for the men and the women that go and serve our nation by joining the military. So maybe that's another thing you can add on your to-do list for this celebration. And even beyond that, I try when I'm in a store and I see somebody that has a t-shirt on or a ball cap and it says something about being a veteran, I tell them thank you. Thank you for serving our country. Thank you for having served our country. And I really want to put a plug in for the Vietnam vets because they did not come back to a welcoming country. And I think that was part of our downfall, that we did not recognize what they did. They were obedient to doing what they were told to do. It doesn't make any difference whether you agree with what happened politically or not. They did their job, and a number of them did give their lives. We have our freedoms because of others that went on before us. Again, I want to read this to you. When a number of people were asked how they celebrated the 4th of July, do you know what answers they gave? What are your answers? And there's nothing wrong with these things. Believe me, the first one that I have here is fireworks. As a kid, I grew up next to the Atlantic Ocean in New Jersey, and so we would go down to the beach, and the fireworks were tremendous. I loved it. It was great. It was a wonderful way to end our celebration of the 4th of July. Parades, picnics, barbecues, family and friends were the typical answers given. But that shouldn't be the end of what we do. We have a lot to be thankful for. And again, I want to plug for the United States because I do feel this country can be the greatest in the world. We have to do some work, especially educationally. We have kids that are graduating from high school. They cannot write a sentence and they can't read. And forget about math and science. Those are way out the window. We need to help this country regain what it has lost. And again, freedom is not free. It costs a lot. It comes at a great cost, often at the cost of someone's life. Be mindful that our founding parents, what our founding parents pledged to each other. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, meaning God, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. They were willing to give that in order to have freedom. What are you willing to do to help freedom? And then I'm going to use that as a springboard, because there is a freedom that is available to all. It cost us nothing, but it cost the one that offers it everything. The greatest freedom of all was purchased for the entire world. How many of you are familiar with John 3:16? For God so loved the world that God gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, what do we get? It's not just life on this earth, eternal life. When you breathe your last breath on this earth, you can have eternal life. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. That is also from the book of John. It's from John chapter 8, verse 32. And then John 8, 36 says, and I love this, so if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. There's a freedom that is offered by the Bible, but you have to spend time in it. We need to learn it. We need to remember that because of the shed blood of Jesus, we have been bought, we have been purchased by the price of Jesus, our Yeshua, Messiah's blood. And we're not our own, we belong to him. I'm going to read several more scriptures to you that talk about freedom, and these are not the only ones, there's a lot more. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. Acts 13:39 is an interesting scripture. Through him, everyone who believes is set free from every sin. A justification you were not able to obtain under the law of Moses. And I'm going to expound upon that a little bit, because you may not know that the law of Moses, they had, if you did this, then you had to do this, this sacrifice. You did that, there was this sacrifice that had to be given. They had a whole entire system. They had 615 guidelines, I'll call them, for people to follow. Now there is one. Confess your sins, and God is faithful and just to forgive. It cost us nothing, but that it cost Jesus, our Yeshua Messiah, everything. Romans chapter 3, verse 24, and all are justified freely by his grace, through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Romans 8, 2, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. Oh, death, where is your sting? Sin can be washed away, wiped away through the shed blood of Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. What we have received is not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may understand what God has freely given us. We need to learn more about that. What has God given? It's like being offered a gift, a present, and it just sits on the table because you've never received it. That present isn't yours until you open it up. And that's what God wants us to do. Galatians 5:13. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. Now, if we started to live that, then we would see this country get back to its roots. We would see this country regain what has been lost over the however many years that it's been, that we've been going down the tubes. Slippery slope, but people don't know, because you know what the United States is number one in? We are number one in self-esteem. It's okay that we're going down the tubes. It's okay that we have $19 trillion debt, but we feel good about ourselves. Doesn't matter about anything else, does it? You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. Freedom in Jesus. If you have been set free, then you are free indeed. Perhaps we do need to recall why people left their homes, families, good circumstances to come to this land originally. Freedom to worship God according to the dictates of their hearts and their minds. They were under tyranny. They were told there was only one church that they could belong to and that this is how everything was to be done. And there was a group that said, no, that is not how we're going to do it. And they risked their lives to come here. And there were many, many, many that died. And then years later after that, we've got to be a colony. The 13 original colonies, but then the 13 original colonies said, we're not going to do that. They already had new homes. They already had all that their family could have possible at that time in history. But they were again willing to risk it all, to lay down their lives so others could live in freedom. Jesus laid down his life so we could have eternal life. It cost him everything. So I want to return back to our nation because I want us to have the greatest, greatest celebration of all. And I'm going to close with a picture from this book, which is The Flag We Love. And it has a beautiful picture of our flag and fireworks. Let's make some new fireworks.